how this next map is going to go, considering this is going to be destination. It's a little bit of a tighter area for both these players to have to operate in. And that seemed to be how Evil Eye was able to get such a strong presence on that map, was kind of alternating between this massive map and going back and forth and forcing that slow push to have to go back and forth with him. But in the top left-hand corner, we've got our red Protoss player, Evil Eye.
And in the bottom right, we have the peach-colored Terran, DNH. And I have to agree with you, this map is very interesting in terms of TVP play. First of all, it's very easy to split the map for Terran, considering the fact that in the middle, there are two bridges. If you control two bridges there, you have a golden opportunity to split the map in half, which always favors Terran, as I told you earlier.
Right.
At the same time, Terran has a great opportunity to control both of its natural and its third base that is kind of behind, in this case, behind the middle line and to the top, to the right of it. I'm not going to force you to do it, but if you turn on your full vision, you could see that the siege tanks can be placed along the ridge in the main base that cover both bridges. The bridge that leads to the... I'm sorry, you click on the eyeball on top of the mini-map, and you click on reveal entire map on the bottom left of the menu. Yeah, so if you notice where that SCV is just now, he can actually place siege tanks up there on that ridge. And siege tanks up on the ridge that is directly to the left of it, and cover both ramps just with siege tanks in his main base. So it's pretty much a free three base for Terran in a certain sense. Meanwhile, Protoss has... I can't really imagine many advantages that Protoss has on this map. I mean, Protoss still does reasonably well. One of the greatest advantages that Protoss has on this map is the fact that the mobility of Terran is greatly hampered by all these bridges and tight contained places, so carriers actually kind of were revitalized on this map, or at least were prominent on this map, as opposed to Arbiter play. And I know... Ooh, this probe is blocking the depot. I want to see the micro here.
Yeah, I'm kind of curious as well. Ooh, no, he's actually not going to use that other SCV to block throw down the supply depot. So, probe is just going to block the supply depot, and the SCV is going to be... A little distracted doing that. I mean, it's still at 14, so he can still throw down the supply depot. Yeah, he's good then.
There he goes. Yeah. So it looks like we're going to be shaping up to a very standard game. Protoss going for an extremely standard. You go for 10 pylon, 12 gateway, 14 CC, and then 15 pylon. This is the bread and butter of Protoss versus Terran. This is how pretty much all of your games should start, unless you're doing something absolutely crazy. Or unless you're really fancy and you're going for Zealot Aggression. But on this map, it's not popular because of the fact of this easy wall that we mentioned earlier. And Terran, at the same time, is going for a factory, but he only has one SCV on gas. I'm curious to see if the Protoss is cognizant of this fact.
Yeah, if you notice that, then it means that, I mean, it's generally going to be pretty signature of a fast expansion right after this. Siege Tank, fast expand. So,
I can't agree with you completely there.
Really?
It is going to be Siege Tank, but it is most likely going to be an FD, fake double, which is one Siege Tank mine upgrade.
Right.
For a Siege Expand, you actually want two SCVs on gas because you're going to get Siege Mode and a Siege Tank. Siege Mode costs more gas, and Siege Tank costs more gas, and you want at least two to be safely expanding.
Today I learned I've been Siege Fast Expanding incorrectly.
Well, if you notice,
the woes of a D-minus player.
Yeah, so if you notice right now, right? So this machine shop, right, is being added right now. Siege Tank is coming up. And even though he added the second SCV a little bit later, he still does not have enough gas to even get mines on time. So you already have to feel that he's not going for... Well, I mean, you know that he's not going for anything aggressive, but he's definitely not going for Siege Expand. He's probably going for a Mine Expand right now.
Mm-hmm. Yep, so as soon as that Siege Tank comes out, I guess we'll start to see what he's going to move into next. We already have the Command Center coming out here.
Oh.
Meanwhile, Protoss...
He is going for Siege Expand. He just did it very, very late. You generally want your Siege Mode to be done a little bit earlier, considering the fact that you cut so many Marines. If you notice, he only has two Marines and one SCV and one Siege Tank. Any sort of all-in here would have hurt him really badly and prevented him from taking the expansion because his Siege Mode is so delayed. Maybe he made a calculated risk in this scenario. He knows that Evil Eye is not going for a very aggressive build, so he allowed himself to delay it a little bit, but I still think that it could have been done a little bit better. If you notice, the siege mode is not even done yet. The dragoons are already pushing up the ramp. If all three of those dragoons were there at the same time, it could have been trouble. It could have. If your first tank gets lost in a siege expand, that's terrible. And that, we might actually still see it. This SCV is doing a great job of spacing out these dragoons, but let's see how the micro goes out. And this siege tank is being pushed back, and this is exactly what I was talking about. Now his expansion is effectively denied for a certain amount of time. Meanwhile, the Protoss expansion is 75%.
He's going to lose the siege tank as well. He's going to have to force all these SCVs to come out here and to be able to handle off this dragoon. There's going to be one SCV going down as well, but that does give Terran a little bit of breath here.
Yeah. So I would say that you were right and you were wrong. All right, so you were right that he was going siege expand, but you were wrong because you were right for the wrong reasons.
I was right for the wrong reasons. I love it.
Yeah, it's like what Idra says, right? Like, right. You know, like you played so bad that you won, right? Yeah. So DNH in this scenario, he went for the build that you predicted, but he did the build incorrectly because of the fact that he took too many SCVs off gas, put them back on too late. I can understand the desire to fake going for an FD and then going for a siege expand, but he just didn't put enough SCVs back on. His siege mode was late. Even with the really beautiful SCV micro that he did on the ramp, he still was not able to save that one tank before the siege, and he didn't get the bunker up in time. So as a result, you were right, but you were wrong.
Yeah, it cost him quite a bit, right? He lost that siege tank. He had to move all of his SCVs off in order to handle those dragoons, which loses a lot of mining time, and now he has to rebuild all of those units that he lost again. So while it worked out, he came out even in the eyes of an untrained person. He has to build everything back up again, and siege tanks in this beginning stages are incredibly crucial, especially if there was an all-in. You're right.
Yes. And on top of everything, I feel like StarCraft is very much an exponential game, where if you're behind by one SCV at the first minute, you're behind by five SCVs at the fifth minute, or something like that. So I would say that in result of, you know, you being behind by one siege tank, not only is that a mental detriment, it's also a physical detriment in the absolute sense of the word, where now Protoss has six dragoons and you have three siege tanks. Protoss could comfortably actually walk into this base and kill all three of those siege tanks with just those six dragoons. And I've done that before. I've done that recently where someone, you know, overcommitted to an attack and I had six dragoons and I showed up at their main base and I realized that they didn't have any mines up. So I'm like, oh, I'm just going to walk in and kill all your siege tanks. Like, it's just like a rolling loss. You know, you just keep losing more and more and more because of the fact that you lost that first siege tank with siege mode that was too late.
Because, I mean, that there's a reason why we say the term playing from behind. You have to start coming up with new types of engagements that are going to get you back ahead. The equivalence doesn't, especially between two good players, the equivalence of where the match started and where the match could go has to be determined by the person who's in the power position to lose more than the person who's in the lower position.
Exactly.
And so that's why you generally see things like when behind Dark Shrine, which is the StarCraft 2 phase phrase, but, you know, when behind Dark Templar? I don't know what the phrase is here for Protoss in StarCraft Brood War.
Well,
we need to come up with more phrases. That's how we're going to win StarCraft Brood War.
I can't come up with anything right now.
Dark Templar is a really hard thing to rhyme with.
Yeah, and on top of that, Dark Templar are actually, like, I feel like they're worse in this game than they are, in PvT at least. Actually, in PvZ as well than they are in StarCraft 2. But this thing went terribly for the Protoss. His shuttle was entirely late. He overcommitted way too late. Remember that time when I said that if I had six Dragoons right now, I would have walked in? That was a minute ago. Now, this Terran has successfully fought his way back into a commanding position in terms of army supply. And you can actually see it in the supply right now. Protoss should never be behind in supply against the Terran, more or less for the entirety of the game. And just now he climbed his way back up. And he just squandered all of the advantages that he had up until this point.
And so that's where you start to lose that power position, as we were talking about before. Granted, Protoss, Evil Eye, did grab a third base right behind all of this action. And so that's going to allow him to get possibly some macro going. He doesn't have any probes over here yet, though.
Yeah.
Right now, I'm sure he's focusing on getting all the dragoons out that he just lost.
Yeah, it's an investment and a loss up until this moment right now. And even up until this moment, he's still losing. He is building two forges here. He has not transferred any probes. This so far has been a pure investment with no gain. And one thing that I was going to compliment Evil Eye on is look at his observer placement, right? He has one observer on each of the gas expansions and on the two bridges of the Terran. But at the same time, this lapse in macro has really cost him a lot. He had to invest 500 minerals and then 300 more for two forges. And then he hasn't gotten anything out of this investment for the past 2 minutes. It's a case, and meanwhile, Terran is pretty much gearing up to take their third base as well. So it's going to be dicey right now. This is going to determine which one of these players comes out ahead. It's another crucial moment. And at the same time, we're seeing a drop at the 1130 base.
Yeah, I'm very scared for Protoss at this point because there's absolutely nothing here in the main base. None of these gateways are even producing anything. The fact that everything has to run back here, that gives the Vultures tons of time to throw down all these spider mines.
These mines. Oh, thank God. He mined out that mineral in the back. Because otherwise the probes would have run past. The Zealot might have run past. It would have exploded everything. The mine debuff. And actually, he cleaned up quite nicely. I feel like he got very, very lucky with the way he ran past those mines. Because those mines were perfectly placed for any outcoming units on the gateway. And I would have to say that Terran did the right thing, but it just didn't pay off for some reason. In the meantime, he himself has been having some macro woes, not being able to place the third base during this time. He should have been placing it while that drop was going on.
Yeah, I'm actually kind of curious of what delayed that third base from going down. I don't think there was any units other than this observer over here. I think he just like kind of threw it over there in the move command, but didn't actually, when he saw it, actually throw it down. So that's going to be a little bit of delayed time there for that third base to actually get situated. Meanwhile, he is building up a pretty good force right now at his natural. He's trying to start pushing out on the map. He's got a little couple of siege tanks out here, and he's got a pretty good number of vultures as well.
Yeah, but one thing that I have to say is that you can tell that DNH's multitask kind of suffered throughout that engagement. He has 4 to 3 vultures queued up at each non-add-on factory. He actually had 5 at one point. The ideal ratio that you want to have is 1 tank to 2 vultures. The only reason that he did this is because he was so far up in minerals, despite the fact that he didn't even land his third base, is because of the fact that he was trying to micro so heavily that he ended up costing himself the ability to macro. This is one of those issues where he actually overinvested in the micro and did not invest properly in the micro. And these two dropships are coming in out of nowhere for no reason. And I'm curious.
They're the defense dropships. They make sure that everybody gets really, really curious about what's in those dropships without actually doing anything. Siege tanks are unsieging and trying to move on up here to defend off these Dragoons, but so many SEVs are getting slaughtered in this giant Dragoon push. 55 probes to 42 SEVs at this point.
I would have to say that this was a big mistake from the Terran player. One thing they have to keep in mind is the fact that it's a lot quicker to rebuild one command center than it is to rebuild 10 SCVs, even off of 2. Oh, and that Dragoon Micro, once again, he tried to drag the mine once more, and it just shows the awareness and efficiency of Evil Eye's APM. I keep trashing on this player for being slow as shit, but like honestly, the way that he plays is kind of beautiful.
It is. I mean, like, he's spending every single little bit of APM absolutely perfectly. Like, I haven't seen a slip up where I've been like, oh, well, more APM probably would have saved him in this situation.
It's more like he's shopping at the dollar store while we're paying at like Walmart for the same thing. Like, you know, like buying like, I don't know, like one grain of rice at a time for like 50 cents a piece or something, or where is he buying like a pound
exactly
at Goodwill or something like that, you know? So he is definitely making the most
pound
out of
rice at Goodwill. Sounds like the worst investment that I think anybody could ever have ever.
Hey man you never been there, all right? Pound of rice at Goodwill, it's a good investment.
Well,
right?
It just means that at Goodwill it's secondhand rice. I don't even know what that even means. Like, somebody I don't know exactly what that entails.
It's re-dried, yo.
But
so
it
someone
sounds
it up
pretty awful.
No, people just straight up donate sometimes, all right?
Yeah,
okay. All right. Alright, enough about goodwill. Anyway, I am liking this, the fact that Terran is trying to split this base now again. He's trying to reestablish this position. I would have liked to see more of him taking this other very easy to defend 630 base where he could place command center like two depots and a siege tank behind it, and then a siege tank on the high ground, and he would have it covered. That is his next base to expand to. He could have definitely afforded to do so at this time.
There's only a few amount of Dragoons that are kind of overcommitting at this point, trying to take out all of these spider mines. I actually am a little bit scared of, because if these vultures wrap around, there's going to be a lot of Dragoons that are going to go down for free.
Yes, and as I was telling you earlier, Dragoons are the tanks of Protoss. You don't want to lose Dragoons. Like, in the most traditional, like, imagine your ideal PVT. Oh, and those mines were beautifully placed. The ideal PVT would be that every engagement that you make between two equal players would result in all of your Zealots being dead and all of the enemy Vultures being dead, but neither of you lose Dragoons or Siege Tanks. So just losing Dragoons straight up like that was definitely an overcommittal. I like the way that you put that. He only needed really like two or three Dragoons to clear mines, and there's nothing that he can do on Terran's side of the map right now. And I'm sorry, I'm going to pause right here.
Yes.
This is a crucial decision right here, and I'm sorry, I tend to pause when there's like a crucial moment, because we have that luxury, but Terran had two options here. He could either try to push across this bridge, kind of willy-nilly, if you notice that none of his tanks are sieged up right now, right? And he doesn't have any mine coverage either. Like, he's like, oh, I'm just going to send my shit and then hope for the best, right? If you look at Protoss's army, it's not in a perfect arc, but it's in a really good arc, mm-hmm. with a very zealot-heavy composition. The best option to do here would have been to lay mines on the bridges and then push to the Protoss base that is to the top right, to the, like, 2 o'clock position. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That bridge is, first of all, fatter. Well, not fatter, but it's undefended in this scenario. He is kind of committing too early, and I feel like I'm going to make a prediction right here. He's going to lose a lot of these vultures just to this army coming in right here, and suddenly all of these tanks are going to be undefended, and this zealot heavy composition could push in and do a lot of damage to these siege tanks, as opposed to if the vulture just stayed on the bridge, planted mines on the bridge, and then pushed in the other direction towards somewhere where they could actually achieve something. There is nothing that the Terran force can achieve where those vultures are pushing to right now. There's right. nothing in the middle of the map that they can damage or hurt or otherwise incapacitate the Protoss with.
You know what, I'm going to bring up a point real quick as well, like to kind of parallel that to any other game. It's like when you're in any type of MOBA or team game where you're team fighting over an area that has zero objective for you. There's no point to it. The only thing that could possibly happen is the enemy team possibly loses or you possibly lose, but either way, neither of your, like, you or the enemy team are going to get that much out of a team fight over no objective. In which case, it's best at this point to try and look at what objective, what is my end goal for my next movement? And is that goal to win the game, which is what he thinks he's trying to do right here by pushing into this area? Or is it to get a slight advantage that I can win the game later on, which would be taking out this base over here at the 2 o'clock position? I feel like he's exactly. making a little bit of a brazen decision of, like, I'm just going to push in here and see if I can get a siege and win.
Yeah, he kind of just, he went all in blind, more yes. or less. He doesn't have to do this, and I'm going to play it now. I yep. feel like we've set our part on this. Okay, I actually like this. He is retreating back, but now he has also lost the initiative. Now he doesn't have the option of pushing across his bridge. He has to secure his investment in this push. He's not going to be making any aggressive moves, and that comes back down to mentality. At the same time, Protoss, who has lost absolutely nothing through this, might be trying to force this mech army out of position right here, going down this way.
Yeah, this is a scary moment here for Terran. He doesn't really have that much defending this base over here at the 9 o'clock position.
And he's committing to defense now. He is actually not fully committing either. He still has 6 exposed siege tanks along those bridges. And once again, a case of undercommitting. Did he cancel that command center?
He did.
So not only is he committing to a defense of a base that he just lost, I mean, okay, Protoss is making a huge mistake here walking down this tight ass ramp also. So this might actually be, again, a scenario where both players did the wrong thing. but Terran had absolutely no imperative to defend a base that he just canceled.
Oh my god, he is losing so much into this.
Oh my god, that is, yeah, that's tragic actually. So in this case, if I was Terran, I would unsiege everything and just keep pushing the way that I was pushing in the first place. I would push right, well, not the same way, but I would push
trade
right
base
back
for base.
Yeah.
That's actually a good call. I mean, I would feel at this point that that was where DNH was saying, oh my god, if I let this base go, that could very well cascade into the next base going down. In which case, if I don't win that fight, that could have been a major loss for me. And so I should go for the defensive option and hope that I actually stop that cascade, that giant waterfall of forces, to going down to my 8 o'clock base.
Oh, no, you're right. I definitely did not consider that because I did not notice how undefended this third base from him is. Yeah.
That 8 o'clock base has zero things defending it except for a single missile turret.
But once again, he has split up his tank forces, something that you never want to do as a Terran that is aiming to push. And I do feel like, I mean, all right, his Zealot heavy composition has forced DNH to be Vulture heavy, but again, he's pushing through this narrow bridge. And the observer placement is still just so beautiful. Like, Evil Eye knows exactly what DNH is going for in this situation. So he's going to be able to group up really quickly.
Yeah, he's got this science vessel, but he's really not doing that much with it. He's able to detect the observers, and that's great, but he's not able to really cause that much problems for the Protoss with it. Now, granted, there is finally an Arbiter out here. The Vultures are handling these Zealots really well. A huge concave is coming out here from Evil Eye. But DNH is able to defend it off and push back the Protoss force.
That was a really great retreat. Once again, he saved his Dragoon, so I feel like he didn't lose more than like two or three in that whole engagement, which is exactly what you want from an engagement in PvT. But I would have to still give DNH the advantage here, despite the fact that Evil Eye has the supply advantage. Because of the fact that DNH has bridged that gap. He has crossed over into enemy territory, and now he's going to lose exponentially more what's called Dragoons, just trying to stay alive. And now he's definitely overcommitting.
Couple of good stasises, though. There's only three sea shanks that are available to attack with this. Science Vessel is trying to detect as much as possible, but with all the Zealots pouring on in here, this is actually going to cause DNH to lose all of his forces out here into No Man's Land.
But DNH, he has to utilize this remaining force really well. He has to prevent the Protoss from coming into this his half of the map. And I love that defensive matrix. That actually did a crucial part in saving that tank. But losing this vessel would be crucial, and he loses it.
Yeah, he's going to lose a lot of forces here. Now the Sea Shank has no defensive matrix on it. It's going to fall. We're going to see the Vultures trying to push back those Zealots yet again. The Sea Shank starting to come back out of that stasis.
Oh, nice.
And that's actually going to get him a couple more kills with a really good Spider-Mine hitting as well.
Yes. Oh, man. This whole engagement was actually played really well by both players, I feel like. They both were constantly reassessing what they were doing, as opposed to there, where he lost like 10 Zealots for freebie. But
he actually snuck some Vultures in here as well to deny this this base over here at the 10 o'clock position. And he got a lot of Zealot kills with some Spider Mines.
Yeah, so remember how I told you that these two series would probably be like an hour and a half? I didn't consider the fact that these games would be so tight. I mean, this just shows you that like I have no spoiler on this. You know, like this is beautiful EMP. I'm sorry, I have to cut myself off here.
Yeah, sure.
He brought his vessel. He scanned where the two Arbiters were, and he brought it in, and he EMP'd both Arbiters at the same time. This is something that as a Protoss player, you should be always cognizant of. You don't want to keep all of your Arbiters grouped in one group. If you notice, he has four Arbiters stacked in one place right now. One EMP neutralizes four Arbiters.
Yeah.
And that is just such a huge loss for a Protoss player.
Well, he hit two of them. The other two came back, I think, from where they were being rallied to. So he's got two that you can notice that didn't get affected to that because they have full shields. But that's going to be a huge loss in the next couple of engagements if he's only got two stasis fields available.
No, but I guess the overarching thing of what I'm trying to say is always keep them hotkeyed separately so that when you space out your army, the Arbiters are always in different locations, so you can never EMP all four at the same time. Because even right now, I would trade a CC for EMPing all four Arbiters, because that means no recalls are coming. My next push is going to be stasis-free, and let's see if he actually reacts to this. Does he have a vessel that could EMP? He has a vessel with 127 APM. He can do it. What we see? Oh, and now we're seeing Evil Eye. Look at that spread. Look at that spread. There this is go. Exactly yeah. what I'm talking. Yes, this is what I wanted to see in the first place. And actually, major props Ooh. To DNH for. Oh wait, but this backdoor.
This is gonna be pretty devastating. There's a lot of Zealots coming in here to deal with all of these vultures and siege tanks. There's a single Goliath over here, but so many spider mines are doing a good amount of damage to the Protoss army here. But now is where we're going to start to see that go right back over to to Evil Eye. He's able to push straight on through here. There's a lot of forces that are stasis that he can just wait around for. Oh, but DNH coming out to siege tanks.
Yeah, Evil Eye kind of took a break real quickly for no reason almost at all. And now this whole army is going to be cleaned up. He has to save the Arbiters. He has to save as many Dragoons as possible. And he's actually trying to expand to this base as well. If you notice that Evil Eye is actually mined out of more bases on his side of the map than DNH is, I believe.
Mm-hmm.
DNH only mined out two. Evil Eye is pretty much mined out of... Evil Eye is also only mined out of two. The third base is kind of skimpy. The top right is also a little bit skimpy, but I feel like this is one of the beauties of this map. I feel like this map was almost made to play TVP on, because it is such a back and forth. It is such a bridge game. It is such a positional play. And it all comes down to, I feel like DNH has to slow push up this ramp.
Yeah, this is going to be really difficult for him, though, because, like, Sea Shanks and Vultures are not the, like, I mean, granted, Dragoons are generally, like, the clunkiest units to go up and down next to Goliaths.
Oh, this EMP hits all four Arbiters. They were all grouped together.
Ooh, that's going to be devastating. It
actually hits, yeah, that's really bad for him. But at the same time, he's not sieged up. He's not properly sieging up behind this as well. These Zealots could actually take out a lot of tanks for free.
Another EMP goes down. That's going to wipe away all the shields there of the Protoss army that's trying to defend this this 9 o'clock base. He's trying to push down yet again. Vulture's trying to defend those siege tanks away from the Zealots. That's not going to be too successful. Another defensive matrix going to go down here.
And this battle is just... It's a war of attrition. This is, once again, what I was telling you about how Brood War, I mean, you've said it yourself, I've heard you say it before too, is how Brood War is different from StarCraft 2. This battle of attrition is something you just don't see in StarCraft 2.
Right.
And not to hate on StarCraft 2, but it's just this positional play is something that is born of the high ground advantage, is born of the defensive advantage.
Ooh, Archon's coming in out of nowhere with DTs! The DT's gonna get cleaned away pretty quickly though, because granted, there's a ton of detection here.
Yeah, Archons are a sign of desperation from a Protoss player, because one EMP and that Archon is useless. That Archon becomes, like, less health than a probe, and that's the EMP, and suddenly all the Archons go down. And now these Arbiters are going to go down, and these probes are going to go down. Now, this is actually a very crucial moment, and another EMP on the last Archon that is there. This has been a tragic moment for the Protoss army. I mean, even fighting uphill, the siege tanks are so strong, and if you notice, despite the fact that he has only 120 APM, which is actually more than he's ever had before, Evil Eye is broke as hell right now on 400 minerals, and Terran's actually in a decent position. He still has not claimed his other gas on the other side. Like, he still has that option available to him. There's an observer there, there's an engineering bay, but he still can take that base, so I feel like the Terran positional favoritism is playing out here, especially against Arbiter.
And I mean, this I think comes back right down to Evil Eye not being able to really take leverage over the fact that he could push the Terran army back and forth across the map. You could see that he was kind of pigeonholed into forcing him to left or right, and we could see that DNH was kind of prepared for that quite often. Now, we kind of criticized DNH a little bit for constantly going for that defensive option, but Evil Eye always overcommitted on each of these pushes.
Oh, most definitely. And I feel like actually both players have been overcommitting to every one of the pushes. And I mean, we said in the last game that DNH didn't commit enough, right? But DNH kind of overcommitted in the wrong direction in this game so far, except for when he's making defensive choices. And whereas Evil Eye is overcommitting into defending a third base that's not mining yet. Well, not third base, I'm sorry, the 9 o'clock base that's not mining yet. He sent four Arbiters there that all got EMP'd. He lost like three of them there. DNH overcommitted to crossing the bridge. So it's a case of, in this case so far, I would say poor decision making, poor situational awareness. And obviously, it's much easier from the eagle eye, from where we are sitting, to say that, oh, this was a poor decision. And I completely appreciate that, because I look at my own replays, I'm like, damn, I'm retarded, right? But
yeah.
But at the same time, you have to always, if you're trying to improve, you have to be a little bit more cognizant, you know. And that's exactly what this league is aimed for, is the fact that we're trying to make these players be more cognizant of these options and the situations. And right now, for example, Evil Eye is pushing out through the back door, but what is he going to achieve? There's no base there for him to conquer. Is he going to try to expand there himself, considering the fact that he might be losing this base over here at the top left?
Yeah, I think that this is his only decision right now, is that he has to expand to a different base, and this is the only one that's available. But
you're
at the same time,
he's actually mined out. He's mined out of every other base, and he is blocked in by the vultures over here in stasis on the top left. So you are right. He has no option but to take this base, and this is again one of those map splitting techniques with all the tight choke points that Terran has the advantage of on this map.
But Terran has all these siege tanks on the low ground, and he has a high ground advantage as well.
Ooh, this recall right here came in right in the nick of time. The EMP hit just a little bit too late. It's always amazing, like, when you play Protoss, right, or when you play Terran, you throw an EMP on an Arbiter, but the recall still comes in anyway, and you wonder why. This time, we actually had the luxury of seeing exactly why that happens. But now, more and more vessels are coming out. This Arbiter has to run away. He realized this investment was an overinvestment. Good call by Evil Eye. This Arbiter is running away. He's probably going to do another recall somewhere else. And this base is actually denied, and actually, DNH himself is actually only on one mining base as well. He still has not claimed that easily defensible base at the 10 o'clock position.
Yeah, this he's losing a lot here. He's gonna lose his base. I mean, granted, Evil Eye is gonna take a lot of losses there, but with these massive recalls left and right, this is huge.
Storm, beautiful. Oh, all right, second storm was kind of like buffered in, but otherwise, I mean, this game is turning into something that is extremely tight. I mean, Evil Eye is actually not mining really very much at all right now. I mean, he only has one base as well, and now DNH is the one that's not mining at all. So suddenly, very quickly, with the power of two recalls, this whole game kind of flipped on its head.
Yeah, this is going to be really scary at this point, because at this, like DNH is at 135 army supply, and he doesn't have any other extra money. That's it. He has 470-some. Now, granted, Evil Eye is at about 1300, 900 now as he's spending more, but he's at 176 food supply. If he can actually be as cost effective with his food, he's in the dominant position.
Oh, you're definitely right about that. And the other thing that to note is that actually the SCV count is slightly in the favor of the Terran player. So in terms of army, like the fact that there's 40 more army for Protoss, it's actually way more than you would expect. So this push from the back door that's happening right now in the middle of the map is actually going to throw off the Terran way more than it does the Protoss. Protoss who is already mining, Protoss who does not have a burning command center, Protoss who is gaining traction now in the middle of the map. He is somehow actually bringing this fight over onto the Terran's map for pretty much the first time in a long time. Mm-hmm. So this is a very crucial moment. It's all about this engagement right here. How are the mines, how are the siege tanks going to play out? And these siege tanks have to be sieged up right now.
Oh, but this is a very scary thing. You don't want to push into that as a Protoss. He's going to lose one Archon for his worries.
Yes, but I do also have to give credit for him to the fact that he is retreating at the same time. But at the same time, are we seeing another push that's going up? One siege tank push. One siege tank is all I needed with five vessels pushing up to the last mining base of Protoss. But Protoss is actually threw down the Nexus, and now this engagement in the middle with two beautiful stasis. Oh my god, and these Archons and this Dragoons, they're... Oh my god, that was a beautiful stasis on both sides of the Terran army. And now all I would love for him to just camp there and wait for those tanks to unfreeze, so he just makes sure that the Terran doesn't have any tanks left.
But he doesn't have to. All he has to do at this point is just push on into this other base to deny the Terran from mining from anywhere. And EMP is going to be able to deny a lot of shields there for the Protoss army. There's only a single Goliath holding this whole entire base. Oh, I'm sorry, there's a couple more Vultures as well. But there's not much past that, so he doesn't even have to wait for those stasis to like kind of come out. He wants to get all the mining out of here immediately.
You're right. And honestly, I would have to say that I think that was a big risk for him to take. I would have rather stayed there and killed all the siege tanks than made a desperate push, because there was, I don't feel like there was any way of knowing for him that Terran was so desperate to hold this third base that he only had one Goliath with D-Matrix on it. You always want to go for what is certain versus what is a risk, but in this case, it's definitely paying off in Evil Eye's favor. And he manages to secure his base. He got another base, which the Vessel is aware of, but now Terran is not mining at all. Terran is in dire straits right now.
Well, he's got all these science vessels over here, though, that have full energy. He actually even spent an EMP on these probes over here.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh my god, I see. Oh no, it was mainly for the Nexus. The Nexus loses half of its health against these things. So, oh my god, this engagement is, again, crucial. And actually, Protoss does not have much to fight against these siege tanks with, and this Terran is using the last of his minerals to reinforce, and this is actually, once again, a very crucial game. This is, once again, one of those momentous moments where if Terran can roll with this push and just leave a few siege tanks here just to take out this Nexus and then cut across the map and take out this other base, that would be so incredible for him. Because both players are pretty much equivalently broke at this point.
Yeah, this is where it gets scary, because you can see how many Templar are coming out here for Protoss. He's down to just spending all of his gas instead of his minerals. But with so many science vessels, with so many EMPs left, that force can be eliminated in half a second.
Oh my god. It all comes down to how quickly does DNH push across the map right now, honestly, because he was supply ahead up until a minute ago, and the only supply that Protoss really has is mostly devoted in Archons, Arbiters, Dark Templar, units that are so highly dependent on their shields. EMP is a crucial moment here. And oh my god, oh no, this is... This push had to have come so much sooner. This push had to have started right now, but the siege tanks are still sieged up in the other base. DNA is focusing in the wrong moment, at the wrong place, in the wrong time.
He gets those EMPs down. Or at least
EMPs
one.
Are crucial. Yeah, and let's see another one. Oh, that nullifies that whole entire army. Oh my god. DNH has to go now. DNH has to go now with everything that he has. He is actually way more money than Evil Eye does. He needs to overinvest at this moment. And actually, wait, look. DNH just nabbed that third base that I was telling you about. That natural third base that I've been waiting for him to take. He actually just floated his command center there and he took it. And now, oh my god, this is so hard to call it. It's impossible to say. And I love the fact that DNH added Dragoons and Zealots into the mix. This game just got so much tighter, and this is shaping up to be an amazing game, in my opinion. This is
scary at this point. I mean, like, I'm scared for both these players. The Terran has to make sure that he doesn't get stasis in, like, just the worst way. But at the same time, I'm kind of, like, impressed as well as shocked that he hasn't used this 4 o'clock base before now. It's taken him so long.
I feel like he just missed his window right now, right? Like, right here, right now, the Terran missed his window to be an aggressive player. If he had pushed into the last mining base of Protoss, he could have done so much damage, but now it looks like he's just going to slow crawl his way across these high grounds, and let's see how well he does in that adventure.
But this favors Terran so much. This is exactly what the Terran army is built for. We can see that only way that Evil Eye was able to get any type of advantage before was by, like, abusing that massive amount of force your forces back and forth. We can see already that there's no stasis force fields going down, but the Terran is actually getting kind of shredded apart. The Archon's going for the close engagement here. The defensive matrix keeping those siege tanks alive for a really long time. The Dark Templar getting detected and taken out. There's no other forces here to defend the Protoss.
And this is going to be the crucial turning point of this match. Whether or not the Protoss can hold on to both bases, but now we have some army coming in from the back. Are they going to be doing enough damage in order to nullify the Terran's last existing army?
And yeah, I think that's it.
Go ahead.
I think there's not much else here for Evil Eye to defend with. He's only got one mining base. It's just about to be gone. Whereas the Terran has one that it's fully mining from and another one that's about to finish up.
And yeah, this is definitely dire straits, but we see also Evil Eye pushing over across the map, trying to deny this Terran's base that he's trying to set up, his, I guess I would say, sixth base at this point. It's another critical moment. Let's see how well he's doing.
He takes out a couple of these siege tanks. Defensive matrixes are going to keep these siege tanks alive for a little bit longer. He's able to force down a couple more Archons in order to deny this base as much as he can. But an EMP goes down on at least one of those Archons. Oh, now he's smartly taking out some of those science vessels. Evil Eye throws down the GG, and that will be game number two. Wow.
Jesus fucking Christ.
Yeah, how many beer bottles are you knocking over right now?
I'm just trying to organize right now.
Organize my beer bottles. Organize my addiction. Dude, that was a very great game. Back and forth, and I love that Darknet Hunter was able to come out on top, because that means that this game's going to go at least one game longer than the last series.
Oh, most definitely. And I feel like both players really showed something that we've been missing in these past few series, and which is a battle of equals. I would say that it was a scenario where the map, the strategies, the tactics, they all played out either in favor or disfavor, to the point where both players just kept breaking even on every interaction. Everything was almost a zero-sum game, where the slight advantage that you gained in the first battle was lost in the second, and then regained in the third, and then lost in the fourth, and so on and so forth. And that was probably one of my favorite games of the entire league so far, I would say. That was definitely up there. So, go ahead.
No, I was going to say, let's get on into game number two. I feel like there's not much